in tonight for Charlie Rose, who is recovering from his mitral valve surgery in Paris. Tonight, we begin with a political update on the week's major events in Washington.
When the president declassifies something, he has the legal right to go do that, and he does it only in the national interest of the United States. When somebody else publishes information, then it's a leak. He would say this first one was not a leak, it was a declassification. When it's a leak, it's harmful to the security, national security of the United States. And he has a legal argument here, which is the president has the right to declassify anything he wants. Politically, he's got a tough case to make.
Because
it looks political.
Yeah. What's political and what is in the public interest is surely in the eye of the beholder. I mean, this was the effort to discredit what Joe Wilson was saying is clearly, this was a political problem for the president. And the president and the vice president, if we believe Scooter Libby's testimony and the fact that the White House hasn't rebutted it, suggests that it's true, that they were motivated by a desire to solve a political problem.
Next, a conversation between George Packer of the New Yorker magazine and General Anthony Zinni, whose new book is The Battle for Peace.
And I think the mission of the military is going to even broaden in this end of the spectrum of conflict, because I think we're going to get involved in things like environmental security, severe health issues if we have pandemics and things like that. I think we're going to, we've already become involved in counter-drug operations, border patrol, patrolling, and you're going to see us more and more end up with these missions that require stabilizing societies.
Washington politics and Zinni and Packer next on Charlie Rose.
Funding for Charlie Rose has been provided by the following.
For every drop of yourself you give, get every drop back. We offer over 80 ways to hydrate, energize, nourish, relax, or enjoy every drop of life.
Charlie Rose on PBS is brought to you in part by JPMorgan Chase, providing financial services and solutions to more than 30 million consumers, institutions, corporations, and governments worldwide.
Additional funding for Charlie Rose was also provided by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
Studios in New York City. This is Charlie Rose.
We begin tonight with Washington, where the White House declined to challenge accusations that President Bush authorized leaks of pre-war intelligence on Iraq. The testimony by Vice President Dick Cheney's former chief of staff, Louis Scooter Libby, cited in court documents filed on Wednesday, have Mr. Libby saying that he may have been authorized by President Bush through the vice president to disclose classified intelligence on Iraq in 2003. Here's the response from White House spokesman Scott McClellan in a press conference earlier today.
The president of the United States has the authority to declassify information. I also indicated to some reporters earlier today that the president would never authorize the disclosure of information that he felt could compromise our nation's security. Now, the national intelligence estimate was declassified, portions of it were declassified.
If it had been officially declassified on July 18, 2003, then 10 days before when the information was given out, it was still classified.
Again, you're going back to an assertion that is made in a filing related to an ongoing legal proceeding when you talk about the second part of your question. There's no way for me to separate that question and talk about this issue without discussing an ongoing legal proceeding, and I can't do that.
Joining me now here in Washington are Jay Carney, he's the Washington Bureau Chief for Time Magazine, and David Sanger, White House correspondent for the New York Times. Gentlemen, good to see you both. The White House briefing today, David, you were at the White House earlier today. What was it like there?
It was a pretty brutal exchange back and forth with Scott McClellan, the press secretary. It focused on the fact that Mr. McClellan came out and made the argument that this was not a political declassification that the president had made. In fact, he wouldn't refer at all to the July 8th, 2003 incident in which Mr. Libby met my former colleague Judy Miller and apparently talked about what was in this national intelligence estimate about Iraq.
He wouldn't talk about that.
Instead, he focused everybody on what happened 10 days later, July 18th, when the White House published the executive summary of this national intelligence estimate. Many of us had been asking the White House for many weeks to go ahead and do that. And he said that the president had decided to do that because it was in the public interest to get this information out. And he said because there was no national security damage to be done by releasing this. That was interesting because for months I had been told that the reason that we couldn't have it was that it was classified and still would damage the national security to reveal it.
Why the focus on the date, on when it was classified or not? I mean, what's the big deal?
Well, because the process by which they declassified the broader document or the executive summary 10 days on July 18th was through the normal process, which it was reviewed, redacted, it was decided what could be published and what couldn't, what was a threat, what revealed sources and methods of gathering intelligence and what didn't. That is very conventional when a decision is made to declassify classified information. The way by which Scooter Libby testified, he was told that the president had specifically declassified this information so that he could talk to a single reporter is very unorthodox. In fact, we can't find, I mean, in you know, the short time we've been able to look into this, any other instance where this has been the case. Not to say it didn't happen, but certainly veterans of previous White
House. You mean under any president that we know
of? Not just this president, but other presidents.
Right.
I mean, this is the problem that President Bush and the White House has with this is that it looks extremely Machiavellian, extremely political, and as part of an effort to discredit Joe Wilson, Ambassador Joe Wilson, who took the trip to Niger and came back and said that the suggestions that Saddam was trying to buy yellow cake were not accurate.
Well,
and then wrote an op-ed in the New York Times.
Well, and I went back today and I looked at what Joe Wilson wrote back in July of 2003, and he says, "I have little choice but to conclude that some of the intelligence related to Iraq's nuclear weapons program was twisted to exaggerate the Iraqi threat." So was the White House justified in being angry and wanting to set the record straight?
Well, I certainly felt threatened about this, but remember the environment that went on here. We had been through a few weeks of people questioning the 16 words about this subject that had been in the President's State of the Union address. We already knew a fair bit about the intelligence that had gone into the White House and the questions that had been raised about whether or not, in fact, Saddam Hussein had sought uranium in Africa. And we had some members of the administration already telling us that there were deep questions about this intelligence before Joe Wilson ever wrote this.
Right.
In fact, Secretary Colin Powell said in an interview that we had prior to these events, it was published after that in a fairly lengthy story, that by the time that he had gotten to make his presentation at the United Nations about the case against Saddam, that very dramatic day where he's in the well of the UN, he had left this uranium issue out because he had determined that it was no longer credible.
But what difference does that make? I mean, that the administration... So the administration was starting to talk about it, you're saying.
By this time, remember, the invasion had happened, and the issue of, you know, Baghdad had been taken, the insurgency hadn't really begun, but the issue of where were those weapons of mass destruction and what was the problem with the intelligence, this was a hot topic of debate. And the fact that this particular sentence in the State of the Union proved to be so uncredible was it a huge embarrassment for the White House, and they saw it as the beginning of an unraveling of their argument for going to war. What interests me in this, Judy, is the centrality of the role played by the Vice President of the United States. As it was so central in making the case to go to the war in Iraq, it was obviously central in the effort to rebut critics of the intelligence and critics of the White House coming out of it.
You don't think the fact that the president himself has now been pulled in is...
Well, I think it's fascinating, but the prime mover here is it's the Vice President's office, and it was the Vice President and the Vice President's office that was particularly animated and exercised about Joe Wilson's op-ed, because in that op-ed, he suggested that it was the Vice President who had sent him on this expedition to Niger, and they wanted to knock that down.
He was the one who had the motivation, more motivation than anybody. David, what about, again, quickly, this Scott McClellan today trying to say, we were doing this to set the record straight. It was in the public interest to set the record straight. He was saying it's different than a politically motivated leak which we've been criticized. We've been criticizing. People are saying, wait a minute, there's hypocrisy going on, but Scott McClellan is saying, no, this is different.
No, he argued that it was quite different. In fact, he made a comparison at this morning's gaggle, the more informal meeting with reporters that takes place each day, that this was completely different from, for example, from the leak of the information about the NSA's warrantless wiretapping in the United States in search of terrorists. What he said was, when the president declassifies something, he has the legal right to go do that, and he does it only in the national interest of the United States. When somebody else publishes information, then it's a leak. He would say this first one was not a leak, it was a declassification. When it's a leak, it's harmful to the security, national security of the United States. And he has a legal argument here, which is the president has the right to declassify anything he wants. Politically, he's got a tough case to make.
Because
it looks political. Yeah.
What's political and what is in the public interest is surely in the eye of the beholder. I mean, this was the effort to discredit what Joe Wilson was saying is clearly, this was a political problem for the president. And the president and the vice president, if we believe Scooter Libby's testimony and the fact that the White House hasn't rebutted it, suggests that it's true, that they were motivated by a desire to solve a political problem.
Let's put this in some larger context and talk about what else is going. Scooter Libby, does this strengthen his argument against the prosecution, who were saying he lied about talking to reporters and when he talked to them?
Remember, Judy, Scooter Libby will be facing charges of perjury and obstruction,
right,
about the question of whether or not he was a source of the revelation of the name of Valerie Plame,
which is a separate
Joe Wilson's wife and the CIA officer. A completely separate question from the question of the national intelligence estimate. So it's not clear that any of this and what he was authorized to discuss or not discuss
will affect the case.
Goes to the question of perjury.
There are a couple of interesting things in this remarkable filing that the special counsel made. And one is that Patrick Fitzgerald, the special counsel, goes out of his way to state that the president was unaware of the conversation, of the disclosure of Valerie Plame's name that Scooter Libby made. He does not say the same thing about the vice president. Doesn't mean that he's not saying that the vice president was aware, but he makes it clear that the president was not. Also, the document is, the filing was designed to rebut a request by Scooter Libby's lawyers for all sorts of discovery, all sorts of documents that they were demanding as part of their case. And the tone of this filing is, you have to be kidding me. None of what you're asking for goes to the issues about which you're charged, which is that you obstructed justice and you lied to the FBI. And most of the case that Libby is trying to make is to sort of create all this context that suggests that he, if he said something that wasn't right, he did it inadvertently because he was so busy and there were bigger issues and it wasn't part of an effort to discredit.
It's got to worry the White House in an odd way, though, because this could be the leading edge of where this case is going, which is along the way we get regular information, document dumps about the inner workings of this White House. Can't be a prospect the Bush administration would be looking forward to.
Very quick, while we're on this subject, Karl Rove, is he, I realize his name was part of the whole Valerie Plame suspicions. Any new information on whether he's still, being investigated, off the hook? Do we know any more about
The only hint in the filing that he's still under investigation, which, prosecutors never say you're off the hook because they always want to retain the right to continue their investigation. The hint we have from the filing is that Fitzgerald makes the specific point that Karl Rove will not be called as a witness in the Scooter Libby trial, which suggests that Rove is still under investigation. But it's a very tight ship over there, and I have not got any information about the status of that investigation.
One other name that popped up in stories over the last few months: Richard Armitage, former number two at the State Department. His name anywhere around any of this?
His name was not in this document, and so we have not heard about him in relation to the Libby case.
All right, let's completely change the subject and talk about something that that appeared late last night to be moving through the Senate, and nobody knew where it was going to go after that, but that, of course, was a compromise on immigration, a massive immigration reform package that there was agreement among a group of Republicans and a group of Democrats in the Senate, Teddy Kennedy, John McCain, and others, wherein it looked like they were going to say millions of illegal immigrants can stay in the United States, whereas those who haven't been here as long less than 2 years, and in some cases up to 5 years, would have to go back. This morning, it comes to a vote. There are some votes on the Senate floor. The whole thing seems to have fallen apart. Jay, what's happened?
What's happened is that, Democrats are blaming Republicans, Republicans are blaming Democrats. But I think what happened here is that Harry Reid, the Democratic leader in the Senate, got nervous because he saw the possibility that either through amendments to the Senate version of this bill or later when the Senate version, when the Senate bill had to be reconciled with the extremely different and very punitive House bill, that the result, the law that would be presented to the President of the United States to sign would be unsupportable by Democrats, and therefore they would have to try to filibuster the reconciliation at the end, which would be bad politically, and I think Reid decided to pull the plug now rather than wait for that eventuality.
So the Republicans are right that the Democrats did this? Because both, you're right, the Democrats are saying it was the Republicans, and the Republicans are saying it was
David may have a different perspective, but I think that, the Democrats took the action, but they blame the Republicans for not being sincere in where they were going on it, because they wanted to amend it already. In ways that Ted Kennedy and others, and especially Harry Reid, couldn't live with.
If Ted Kennedy had been the majority or minority leader of the Senate, we would have had a different outcome.
They do have slightly different agendas. I think Kennedy, this has been an issue that he's cared about since his first major piece of legislation when he came into the Senate in the mid-60s was an immigration reform bill. He cares deeply about it. I think he's looking at this more as lawmaking. Harry Reid is looking at it more specifically as a political issue. After all, Harry Reid stands the chance of becoming majority leader of the Senate if the Democrats take back the Senate in November.
David, is this president willing to take on? Right now, we're talking about the Democrats' divisions among themselves and their political calculations. But when this issue, assuming the Senate can get it all back together after the Easter recess, it moves to the House, where it's a tougher slog in terms of the administration. Is a president willing to put himself on the line to get conservatives in the House to vote for
this? That's a fascinating question, and whether he has the political capital to risk putting himself on the line is sort of the central question. We put this question to the president during his summit meeting with Vicente Fox of Mexico in Cancun, just about 10 days ago, one of the hardship trips of this job. And it was interesting. The question we put to the president was, if this bill comes to you without a way of establishing a guest worker program, a way for people to stay in the United States and apply for citizenship, will you veto it? And he wouldn't say that he would veto it. All he said was, I think you're making an assumption that a bill will come to me without this. We interpreted that as an unwillingness to really draw a line in the sand with his own party, and particularly with the House. I mean, after all, this is a president who, at the beginning of the Dubai ports controversy, said, if a bill comes to me that would block Dubai from investing, I'll veto it. He was going to veto that and not this, something he's been talking about for 5 years. So we can't really tell where he stands.
How much is on the line for the president here? How much is on the line for the Democrats? And how could this affect November and the congressional election?
I think that the problems here are largely on the Republican side because, the Republicans are in control. They have a Republican president. And this issue is so divisive within the Republican Party. There are divisions within the Democratic Party, to be sure, over this. But this, you have passionate members of the House of Representatives in particular who would brook no kind of guest worker program, and who, Tom Tancredo is saying he'll run for president and force the, top tier candidates for the Republican Party to deal with this issue at every debate in every state as long as he can last if something like this passes. So it's a problem for the Republicans. The president's motivations are a little different. He's facing a year right now where he may have no big accomplishments, and this is an opportunity to get one. So I think he'd like a bill, but as David points out,
he doesn't
have the political
get
strength.
Get a Tom Tancredo or anybody
He's in a tough spot on this, and he sees it as an even bigger challenge than this, because the president has been warning that the United States and his own party have been moving in an isolationist direction. He began on this theme when he very narrowly passed what would seem to be a very uncontroversial trade bill in the summer. And he got through by one or two votes. Now Dubai, immigration, the path he sees is to a Republican Party that is beginning to build walls in ways that he finds quite disturbing. And that's interesting. It's not a subject he talked about in his first term.
But it's very much out. He's now out there.
He's way out there.
And for him, one of the things that was very appealing to a lot of moderate Republicans, especially, and people who were looking for a new kind of Republican in 2000, was the way that George W. Bush spoke about immigrants and immigration. He said that family values don't stop at the Rio Grande. He was very different from the isolationist.
He's the president from Texas.
Populist.
The governor.
Right,
of Texas.
And he took a very different tact from the then governor of California, Pete Wilson, in 1994, who passed a very harsh anti-immigrant measure, and the Republican Party paid a substantial price for that back then.
All right, final thing. We cannot leave this table without talking about the surprise resignation this week of none other than the former House Majority Leader Tom DeLay. This came just, what, a day or two after his former Deputy Chief of Staff pleaded guilty to charges that he was conspiring with Jack Abramoff, and that in return for money and other favors, he was getting legislation through that Jack Abramoff wanted. Where does this, first of all, where does this leave, we'll talk about Tom DeLay in just a minute, but where does this leave House Republicans? Are they in better shape now, David, because they've taken an issue away from the Democrats? The Democrats were loving beating up on Tom DeLay.
That's their hope. And their hope, and the White House hope, is that this takes DeLay off the table, that the Democrats were planning on going through the summer saying, look, they're running an indicted former leader, and, you know, with each revelation, they were hoping to sort of keep this thing going. And now, you know, it's going to be a lot harder for the DeLay story to be on page one if he has already resigned. And so I've had many people around the administration say to me that they were hoping that this would sort of put an end to it. Now, whether it does, I think, is a little bit of anybody's guess.
Jay, your colleague, Mike Allen, got an interview with Tom DeLay. Take us behind the scenes a little bit.
He spent a large part of the day that Tom DeLay chose to announce or tell his colleagues that he was quitting with Tom DeLay at his home in Sugar Land, and was struck by a couple of things. One was, you know, his utter defiance. You know, he's really leaving the House sort of kicking the furniture. And we saw a little bit about that sort of defiance in the way he handled the Cynthia McKinney incident this week. He said some very harsh, impolitic
things. This is the Georgia congresswoman who had a
run-in
with
a Capitol Police officer.
Right.
And then also his frankness about why he was deciding to quit, which is that he thought he might lose in, you know, what had been, at least up until 2004, a fairly easy district for Republicans. And he basically said, any other Republican will win this district. I might, but I might not. So
do we know if that's true, that now that he's out, that, well, we assume now that he's out, the Republicans have a better shot in the Texas 22nd, right?
I think they do. Okay. I think Nick Lampson's a credible candidate, but it's Texas. It's a Republican-leaning state.
What about the big question here? Is Tom DeLay likely to be indicted? I mean, what's the thinking on that, David?
You know, much of that depends on what everybody else around him is testifying to as they cut their deals with the prosecutors, and that is the great black box of this. You know, as in the Libby case, you know, you sort of never knew up until the last moment who the prosecutors actually were going to decide that they had a full case against. But at this point, I think the bigger question is, you know, how much of a difference it's going to make now that DeLay has taken himself out of this.
I think we don't know. I mean, the noose seems to be tightening with every new plea bargain by a former DeLay associate. I mean, one thing I want to say about the House Republicans without Tom DeLay, they're happy that he resigned because he's become a political cancer, but they're lost without him. I mean, since he resigned his majority leader post,
discipline's
gone.
Know,
they can't run that shop without somebody with an iron fist like Tom DeLay.
And I gather the moderate Republicans, this has given them a reason to believe maybe they can get some of their wishes through. And the conservative Republicans are saying this is our time.
Right. I mean, they're so disorganized and ununited that, as one top Democrat told me this week, they look like us. Yeah, so that's not a good sign for the Republicans.
All right, Jay Carney of Time Magazine, David Sanger of the New York Times. Thank you both.
Thank you.
Appreciate
Thanks.
It.
I'm George Packer of the New Yorker magazine, sitting in tonight for Charlie Rose. Joining me now is retired U.S. Marine Corps General Anthony Zinni. He was a Marine in Vietnam, commander of troops in the Middle East, and a diplomatic envoy. His new book is The Battle for Peace, a frontline vision of America's power and purpose. Welcome, General Zinni.
Thank you, George.
You started out your career as a young second lieutenant in Vietnam in 1967. You were 22 years old, and you found yourself as an advisor all by yourself with a unit of Vietnamese Marines, which was a very unusual mission for the U.S. military at the height of the Vietnam War. What did that do to you? How did that shape your understanding of what it meant to be at war and what it meant to be in an alien culture at war?
I think what it taught me was that it wasn't a matter of just defeating organized forces. It wasn't just a matter of victory in a pure military sense. An environment like that, if you don't, to use the classic saying, win the hearts and minds of the people, you aren't going to win the war. I was seeing us win every battle, but losing the people, or at least the people not making the commitment to take the risk to fight for something. And they didn't feel that we were giving them what they needed to fight for, or demanding of their own leadership that what they needed to fight for. And the value of culture, connection to the people, winning the hearts and minds, understanding there's a dimension to this beyond just the expenditure of kinetic energy on the battlefield, is what impressed me as a young second lieutenant.
Did you find that your superior officers valued what you had learned out there in the villages with the Vietnamese Marines?
I think most of my senior officers, especially the most senior officers, these were officers that fought the Second World War.
Yes.
When they were my age. They fought the battles of the Pacific in Europe. They had a very conventional mindset. This was a very different environment. I think they tried very hard to understand it. They wanted us to understand it. I mean, I went through tremendous education on counterinsurgency, the nature of insurgency, communist guerrilla warfare. But I think it didn't fit their education and their upbringing.
That's right. And today, as we speak, the Army is rewriting its counterinsurgency field manual in response to the Iraq War, which makes me wonder whether we're doomed to keep learning the same lessons over again and forget them and then learn them once again. One has the feeling that cumulative knowledge is maybe less what's going on in America, not just in the military, but in America and our role in the world, than sort of a cyclical forgetting and then being reminded by war what it means to be at war, especially in an insurgency like Iraq. Do you agree with that?
Yes, and I think, you know, if you sort of look through the last century at how this sort of evolution of insurgency has taken place from Lenin to Mao to Che Guevara, and now those that are thinking more about this saying we've actually have a fourth generation of warfare, that it's actually morphed or evolved into something even more complex. You know, what one thing that bothers me, and speaking a little bit about Iraq, when you look at what we face, the enemy in Iraq, it's not a clear-cut insurgency. It isn't like the Viet Cong or a body of insurgents that's cohesive. It's
There's
a real
no
mess.
Ho Chi Minh.
There's no
Little
Chi Minh.
Red Book.
No.
Yeah.
And so it's such a disparate collection of threats. Each one of them may be requiring a different approach to dealing with them. But I also feel strongly, and one of the points I make in the book, that I think the mission of the military is going to even broaden in this end of the spectrum of conflict, because I think we're going to get involved in things like environmental security, severe health issues if we have pandemics and things like that. I think we're going to, you know, we've already become involved in counter-drug operations, border patrol, patrolling, and you're going to see us more and more end up with these missions that require stabilizing societies because of the threats that come out of them and the symptoms that cause us problems.
Well, the key word in your book is stability, and that is the sort of the strategic goal that you set out for America, to create stability around the world. I notice it's not democracy, which is the key word in this current administration. Why do you put so much emphasis on our need to achieve stability around the world?
I think governmental reform, responsible governance, is an element of stability. It isn't the total answer to stability. Instability, the way I define it in the book, is caused because the environment is hostile and a society can't function and deal with the environment, and it causes instability. It could be the physical environment, man-made environment, whatever it is. And the problem becomes its institutions, whether it's a healthcare institution, security institution, whatever it is, can't cope. And what you have to do then is help build their institutions to cope with the environment, or else the symptoms, cutting down the rainforest, changing the climate, growing cocoa leaves and putting drugs on our street, creating a hostile, disenfranchised youth that are willing to blow themselves up, somewhere here in the States, you know, or ending up with a problem that generates health issues that go around the world. You know, you have to help build these institutions. One piece of this is their ability to govern themselves and do it, ideally in a democratic way, but at least in a representational, stable way. But I added the pieces of economic development, of security for their lives and quality of life, reasonable quality of life, and humanitarian issues. So the short answer is stability is broader than just
it's
democracy.
It's not just also just the status quo, because in the old days, stability, which is a word that you would associate maybe with Zbigniew Brzezinski or Henry Kissinger, the realists, the foreign policy realists, essentially meant keeping our friends in power. And one of the sort of critiques of that view is that we kept our friends in power in the Middle East, and that led indirectly to the growth of global terrorism, to jihadism. And so stability can be an illusion if all we're doing is propping up unpopular regimes. You're not talking about that kind of stability.
No, but I'm also not this sort of wild-eyed idealist to say we can change the world, that we are, even though we're the greatest superpower probably in the history of the world, we don't have the power to do everything. We are certainly not the world's policemen. We don't have the resources to change everything. But the point is, we ought to look hard at the instabilities that generate the problems that wash up on our shores, are most dangerous to us, and measure that against what we can do. In some cases, you might not be able to solve the problems and make countries stable or society stable, but in some places you can at least make it reasonable. In some places you may have to contain a threat. In some places, because other issues outweigh your ability to do this, you might have to accept and deal with and contain some of the things that you've said and mentioned in order to get to a position where you can then deal with it because of the priorities you have. This is not a statement of altruistic, goodness that go out throughout the world and try to change it, because I really think these instabilities are now our greatest threat because of what they generate, and the naive belief that we can build walls on our borders, create homeland security organizations that can completely protect ourselves and we can be isolated, I don't think that's possible. I mean, it's necessary to do some of that. I don't want to belittle the efforts there, but you can't keep it away from our shores.
Is George W. Bush a wild-eyed idealist?
Well, I think he feels very passionately, especially about the issue of democracy. I think he sees that as the key to changing the world. I mean, where I might disagree is, again, that's one element of change, and I might disagree in the methodology. I mean, an election doesn't equal democracy. It isn't very simple. It's a complex process to change, especially societies that have no experience in democratic governance.
What do we do about these decaying autocratic regimes in the Middle East that are producing such an unhappy and actually rather militant new generation who are clearly a threat to us? What can we do about it short of overthrowing them, which hasn't worked out so well?
Well, I notice in the Middle East, and I don't want to exaggerate this or make it go beyond what it is, but I see many places in the Middle East the beginnings of reform, governmental reform, political reform, economic reform, social reform and change. And I'm hopeful. That's a good sign. Obviously, there are places where that's not taking place, where it's repressed. But I'm recently back from a trip to the Middle East, and I see people with visions of the future. I particularly see in the younger generations a call for this, a need to move forward, certainly rejecting the idea that they're going to drift back into the 7th century or retain the kinds of systems and social repressions that don't allow their society to develop. I think the key to this, that particular thing, an area, is education. And every time I'm out in that region where I see more progressive leaders and people talking about this, they always keep saying the key here is education. You know, if we build an education system, an education institution that teaches these values, that allows us to develop the intellectual skills to sort of mold our culture and the things and our traditions that we value around the ability to reform and change, and take the advantages that modern world offers and modernity offers, you know, that's the key to success. Not an easy task, a lot of resistance to that. But I am surprised at the talk, and I'm surprised at some of the things I see. I see the role of women changing in many places. I see political reform, the creation of parliaments and elected bodies to make certain decisions and have the power passed to them. I see economic diversity being encouraged, privatization. You know, all of us here would like to see it move much faster and much
greater.
We're
impatient, as you say in your book.
Yeah. But, you know, it's remarkable to see the movement, and it gets you excited, and it makes you want to see it happen faster.
Let's talk about Iraq for a moment. You did a great deal of work on war planning and on post-war planning when you were the commander-in-chief of Central Command throughout the late 90s. What became of your plans, and what are you seeing there today? I guess I would ask, what would you suggest if you had the president's ear?
Well, to begin with, going back to the plans, they were not just my plans. I mean, ever since the end of the first Gulf War, there was planning for possibly dealing with Iraq and the requirement to go into Iraq and take down the regime. And it was about a decade's worth of planning. I mean, it was evolutionary. And in my time, obviously, we had looked hard at the things like the numbers of troops required, the aftermath and what we would face, the reconstruction of the society. And, you know, my problem has been that was seemed to have been brushed aside, brushed off. To quote the Secretary of Defense, the plan was old and stale and on the shelf.
Why do you think he thought that?
I think that prior to 9/11, within the Pentagon, as part of their idea of transformation, there was this belief that you can do things with fewer ground forces, minimal ground forces. I personally felt the United States Army, for example, had been reduced too much, too few divisions. But there was a belief that it should be reduced drastically further, that the need for large ground units was now outdated, passe, and that could be the bill payer for a high-tech military force, the emphasis on precision weapons, on space-based intelligence systems, and that sort of thing. And to me, you know, and to the friends that I had, we had experience, we still believed you can't do that. There are certain situations. We talked about some of these missions.
Somalia, Bosnia, Haiti,
exactly.
All the ones that you cut your teeth on in the 90s.
And those are manpower intensive. You control people and terrain with ground forces. You go into certain types of missions that there aren't technological solutions to them. There's just hard work, interaction, communication with the people. And so when they were hit with 9/11 and then the decision to go into Iraq, I think, and they looked at the existing war plan, it didn't jive with their belief and what they were promoting in the way of the transformation as they envisioned it. And frankly, I think they tried to do it on the cheap. And I think there was a little bit of over-optimistic assessment and assumptions and belief that the exiles could make this all mm-hmm. work. And, you know, again, flowers in the street, greeted as liberators, cakewalks, all those terms that we heard.
Do you think there were active duty generals, because by then you were retired, were there active duty generals who knew this, who knew that this was dangerous, risky, and didn't speak their minds? What should a military officer do in a situation where he disagrees with what his civilian leaders are proposing?
Well, and to answer the first part of that question, yes, I know for sure there were. Now, what an individual does, there's no standard answer.
Can he knock on the secretary's door and say, I just don't think that you've got enough troops in your plan?
Well, much of that is dependent upon the secretary and his approachability, accessibility, and willing to invite that. In my time, the Secretary of Defense was Bill Cohen. Bill Cohen insisted that we have direct access to him, the four stars, the service chiefs, the unified commanders, and our chairman at the time, Hugh Shelton, insisted that door was always open. I've talked to you about us being given the book Dereliction of Duty to read, mandatory.
Book about the failure of Vietnam-era senior generals to tell the truth to their civilian leaders.
And General Shelton, who sent us that book and required us to read it, brought us all to Washington and had the author, young Major McMasters, now a colonel, a very promising officer in the military. And we talked about this, and McMasters talked about what he discovered and what he felt was the dereliction and negligence of the officers at that time, senior officers. And he was dismissed, and in this room of 17 four-star generals, a very exercised General Shelton demanded that You know, we would never let that happen, that we had the full authority to come directly to the secretary, that we were to speak our minds in testimony in Congress. And that was the attitude of Secretary Cohen, too. We met with the President of the United States twice a year. Secretary Cohen asked each of us to tell the President, and he didn't direct us to what we should say. He didn't monitor it or change it anyway, but tell the President whatever we felt it was important for him to hear.
As far as you know, is that kind of atmosphere of openness prevalent in the Rumsfeld Pentagon?
I don't sense that it is, and I have not heard that it is. I'm not obviously inside on this, and I don't want to say something that I have no direct knowledge of. And that's something that I think the senior uniform military leadership will have to decide if they're going to talk about at some point, maybe after they leave the service.
Well, none of them has left the service on principle over the Iraq war that I know of. I haven't seen any senior officer resign in disagreement with the president or the secretary. And I'm wondering, has there been a dereliction of duty again in the Iraq war, in your
view?
Well,
I think, first of all, it would be not appropriate for me to speculate on that. I don't know what goes inside. I don't know what the discussions are. I would say that, you know, you're probably going to have to see, much like happened with the Vietnam era, people like McMaster's and others, and now the Cobra II book by Traynor and Gordon, et cetera, there are going to have to be these looks to make those judgments. Those judgments are difficult to make at the time. When a senior officer decides to resign over a matter of principle, you can only do that once. You know, and it isn't a matter of careerism in your own future. I think in most officers I know that are men and women of high integrity, they're making this decision because they feel it is so significant, so important. It's going to be an embarrassment. It's going to raise questions. They have to be sure of their position and sure that they're right. In addition to that, they're going to be replaced. And so they have to ask themselves, if I'm replaced,
what good are they going to do?
What good is it going to do? Is it going to be someone who would not, at least in a measured way, take into account their concerns?
You have called for Secretary Rumsfeld to be fired because of the failures in Iraq. Why, and what could a replacement do that he's not doing?
Well, just to be clear, I was asked who I might fire, and I gave that view. I'm not on any campaign or call. That's the president's decision. But I think it's important for two reasons. One, you know, I grew up in an organization where accountability was important. The military looks back at itself, critiques its decision-making, its leadership, and we're very hard on ourselves in that respect. Accountability to us, the captain of the ship, the commander of the unit, you know, everything we learn from the very beginning is you accept not only responsibility, but you're willing to stand up and be held accountable. And accountability means you need to be held accountable for decisions that are done and exercised through bad judgment or through incompetence or through arrogance or through discounting information that you should have taken into account. And I think in many cases that has happened. But beyond just accountability and looking back, more importantly, it's the way forward. Do we need fresh thinking? Do we need new minds in this? Do we need people in charge and at the very top, in this case, in the Department of the Defense, that aren't bound up with defending the past, that are constantly having to deal with a media that is resurrecting the past? Are they really free to change course, to admit mistakes and say, well, that didn't work, let's go to this, and when that transition or shift is going to obviously bring doubt upon past decisions? And so I just think to move forward and to have that fresh look, that new look, that openness to new ideas, to send a message to others that we need to work with, that we're willing to listen and hear other ideas, that becomes necessary. I'm not making this statement out of any personal issues. I can't recall ever meeting person-to-person Secretary Rumsfeld, and I have nothing personal against this. I just think it's time for accountability and looking at the way forward, that a significant change should be made.
We're obviously in trouble in Iraq. If you had half an hour with the president, what would you suggest to him?
Well, I think that, you know, there are some things that we can't repair. We can't repair the loss of control for insufficient troops. We can't repair some of the bad decisions that happened in the past, like disbanding the army, debathifying too far, not controlling the borders, too much faith in the exiles that came in that had no credibility, et cetera, et cetera. It is what it is.
And if they had read your plan 6 years ago, they might not have made some of those mistakes.
Some of them, definitely. Others, they would have at least considered. I think at least the assumptions and the possibilities would have shown them much more reality than maybe some of the ones that were maybe, again, overly optimistic.
Okay, but that's the past.
That's the past. Where are we now? I think that we have evolved to a place where we are looking at only two keys to success. One is getting this government to organize in itself in a way where it is a coalition, it's unity, it's representative of the people. In that respect, I think that's not enough. Because even if they do that tomorrow and announce it, that only means they have organized themselves in an acceptable way to begin dealing with the hard issue, the status of the militias, the revenue sharing issues, the nature of federalism and local autonomy, what that's going to mean, the role of Islam in governance. I mean, they have a lot of things on their plate. Are they capable of it? You know, can they deal with it? They certainly won't be in the short term.
And there's also just a daily level of violence that is extraordinary there.
Well, I mean, on the other side, on the security issues, you know, just keep building more forces that are conventionally organized may not be the answer. I mean, within those forces, they need street intelligence. They need a very savvy way with counterintelligence units, the ability on the street to get information, to bond with the people, to get some sort of cooperative way that the people can lead them to where the problems are. These massive offensive operations with tanks and helicopters, you know, they can be counterproductive. They can anger people. They can cause collateral damage, you know, that ends up creating more insurgents than detainees you pick up. So this has to be an organization that becomes more sophisticated and more intelligence-driven than it is in this sort of massive way. I saw in Vietnam where we created a military in our image, you know, for conventional operations, and it wasn't the exact fit in all cases.
Give me your coldest analytical forecast of what's going to happen, not what you hope, but what you think will happen over the next year, both in our position in Iraq and and in Iraq itself.
Well, I think that the worst case for Iraq, as I see it, is it'll go through a period that'll look much like Lebanon did in the 80s, where you're going to have enclaves that are secured in the north and the south. You're going to have sectarian violence and fighting. I mean, it'll be civil war. I don't see that all of a sudden Zarqawi marches to Baghdad and he's the, you know, the Grand Khalifa of Iraq.
It's more fragmented and chaotic.
It's more fragmented and chaotic. It maybe even might even be going on under the fig leaf of some government that's very weak and not able to operate, more concentrated, more violent in certain areas than it is in other areas. But it will fragment, go through this violent period. If it sort of follows a pattern you see in most of this region, that there's a good chance it could actually, after a bad patch of this, you know, several 5 years, then figure out, much like Lebanon is struggling to do, how to put it back together again. You know, I think that's kind of a worst-case scenario, with a violence much worse in going through that. To give you the other end of the spectrum of best-case scenario, I think, you know, this government gets its act together, starts dealing with the hard issues, the security forces become more credible, and that the people begin bonding, and so far they have resisted descending into total civil war, but that's very dangerous because I think they're on the brink. And they fight back. I mean, they fight back away from civil war. There's more intersectarian dialogue and things that go on, as I mentioned. There's some economic development and growth that begins to happen, it's hope. And then, you know, again, I think maybe 5 or 6 years, but maybe on much more of a positive path, not without its bumps, it kind of makes it through and then stabilizes in some way. So to me, that's the band right now. Our role in this, well, there's some obvious things. I mean, we're going to train the security forces. We're going to stand by and be ready to react if they get in over their head or if the violence really picks up in a major way. I would project that we'll probably see ourselves over the course of the next year or more or so that we'll begin not only drawing down forces, but maybe withdrawing forces and putting them in the region, ready to react, but out of the country, and it'll be like a phase down. And I agree with doing this based on conditions, not on timelines. I don't think there's much need for us to wait longer than within this year, because things ought to start breaking one way or the other. I think the beginning of the withdrawal of forces, even if it's out of the country into places like Kuwait on standby, ready to react, maybe closing down some of the large logistics bases, operating out of these places, just putting combat forces in for a short period of time, coming in and out, I think it sends a good signal, because The big fear and the gripe and part of the problem on the ground is this idea that we're going to create permanent bases in Iraq. And I think
that would be a
mistake.
And you're saying that it would be a good signal to say that we're not. Let me ask you one more question. Iraq has left us overstretched, bogged down there. The military is stretched extremely thin. And our moral standing in the world has suffered. Your book is sort of a catalog of crises which we responded to afterward, which we did not anticipate and prevent, but which we tried to clean up after.
Right.
How can we learn the lesson of not waiting until these things become crises and then having to rush in with military force with unknown consequences, but instead anticipate? It seems as though our government is serially incapable of learning to function across the government to anticipate problems around the world and deal with them.
Well, I think that's because we don't understand the new world order or disorder after the end of the Cold War. A number of factors have generated this instability. The collapse of the Soviet Union, the mass migrations, the information age, globalization, you know, you name it. I describe it in the book as the perfect storm of all these phenomena that came together. And so we haven't really read the world right yet, in my view. And in addition to that, we haven't built a strategy for understanding how we, you know, protect our interests, you know, prosper in this world, help stabilize and do all the things necessary to ensure that we have a prosperous and peaceful world. I also say in the book that we don't have the right kind of governmental structure for this. We have an archaic system. We have bloated bureaucracy. We keep adding to the bloated bureaucracy. The problems of bloated stovepipe bureaucracy is lack of communication and integration. When we go to solve those and we recognize the problems as the 9/11 Commission did or the Congressional Commission looked at it, our solutions are to create more bloated bureaucracy. In addition to that, we have systems like patronage, you know, over 3,000 positions that the president fills. We've just seen in Katrina and FEMA where they're not necessarily filled by the greatest experts in the world that are knowledgeable. It's more the patronage and political payoff. We have system of pork. I mean, the latest news tells you about the pig book and all the pork projects. So we're not doing the most effective thing with our treasure, and that's becoming more limited in our ability to deal with it. We aren't organized right. We haven't integrated right. I mean, it's time for this sort of Harry Truman thinking about a new 1947 National Security Act and restructuring, or like a Goldwater Nichols Act that focused on the Department of Defense, but more broadly, a new way of strategic thinking and new organizations on the ground and taking the hard challenge to get rid of some of these practices that now have lasted too long and are now becoming counterproductive. On the other end, in understanding instability, instability comes in phases. When you examine it, where a society has gone unstable, it begins. It is either in a chronic state of instability, or it degrades into one, and then as it goes along, it begins to erupt into a crisis, and then when that crisis passes, or it begins to become into a recovery period. Now, oftentimes, what we do is because we don't have the attention on the first part, where we could maybe help resolve it and steady it with less cost and less involvement. We always wait until the crisis is at its highest point. Then we intervene with the military and the lead.
And then we move on.
Well, and then we move on. So, you know, we try to maybe help in recovery, but that's sort of an iffy proposition. You know, the words being used in Iraq, and I heard this by the planners in state and defense, we would transform Iraq. Well, that's a tall order, to transform a society. I think probably right now we'd settle for reasonable recovery. You know, so what can you afford? What is doable? And sometimes these unstable societies kind of go like a sine wave. They go in and out of this. Mm-hmm. Haiti is a good example, you know, and times when we intervene. But I think we haven't done enough to build international partnerships with NGOs, international institutions, and others, much of which would require our leadership, to say, let's work together. Let's share the burden. Let's find out in the beginning where it's most likely we're capable to mitigate or maybe alleviate. Build those institutions I talk about where we should intervene. Again, this is not altruism. This is actually cost effectiveness. This is flood insurance. We live in the 100-year floodplain. It's time to think about buying insurance. Leadership has to convince the American people that this is a good investment because they can't see it until it's a crisis. You know, and that's what Harry Truman did with the Marshall Plan, the creation and joining of NATO. Those were not popular moves with the people, basically an isolationist society that said, why are we doing this? Why are we footing this bill? But in hindsight, as we look back, it was a wise investment. It got us through the Cold War and stood us in great stead and helped stabilize parts of the world like Europe and Japan and other places that were part of the chronic problem for instability.
General Anthony Zinni, thank you very much for coming in.
Thank you, George.
Funding for Charlie Rose has been provided by the following.
For every drop of yourself you give, get every drop back. We offer over 80 ways to hydrate, energize, nourish, relax, or enjoy every drop of life.
Charlie Rose on PBS is brought to you in part by JPMorgan Chase, providing financial services and solutions to more than 30 million consumers, institutions, corporations, and governments worldwide.
Additional funding for Charlie Rose was also provided by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.